We can all now see the outlines of a post-pandemic world. With vaccinations ramping up in the US and Britain, with Israel and the UAE racing toward herd immunity, it's easy to imagine that a return to normalcy is just on the horizon. The only question seems to be, how long will it take? But we might be seeing a false dawn. Despite the amazing progress we've made with vaccines, the truth is that our current trajectory virtually guarantees that we will never really defeat the coronavirus. It will stay alive and keep mutating and surging across the globe. Years from now, countries could be facing new outbreaks that will force hard choices between new lockdowns or new waves of disease and death. The basic problem is in how the vaccine is being distributed around the world, not based on where there is the most need, but the most money. The richest countries have paid for hundreds of millions of doses, often far in excess of what they actually need. Canada, for example, has pre-ordered enough to cover its 38 million residents five times over. Meanwhile, Nigeria's 200 million people have not received a single dose of the vaccine. Rich countries make up 16% of the world's population, yet they have secured nearly 60% of the world's vaccine supply. In a recent Foreign Affairs article, Thomas Boyke and Chad Bown pointed out Australia, Canada, and Japan have less than 1% of the world's coronavirus cases, but they have locked up more doses of potential vaccines than all of Latin America and the Caribbean, a region with more than 17% of global coronavirus cases. Even though several African countries have been used for vaccine trials, almost no sub-Saharan nation has received vaccines in any significant quantity, while more than 40 million doses have already been administered in rich countries. And Duke University researchers say many developing countries will not be fully vaccinated until 2024, which means that the virus will have years to spread and mutate. In their annual letter, Bill and Melinda Gates note that low and middle income countries will be able to vaccinate only one out of every five people over the next year. Like it or not, we're all in this together, they say. The problem goes well beyond public health. The International Chamber of Commerce has released a study showing that this lopsided vaccination of the world will cause global economic losses of between $1.5 and $9 trillion, of which half could be borne by the richest countries in the world. Looking at data from 35 industries and 65 countries, the study concluded that the world economy is so interconnected that having large areas of it still suffering from COVID-19 would produce bottlenecks, frictions, and loss of demand that would affect everyone everywhere. Another study estimates that rich countries would get back $5 in economic output for every dollar they invest in vaccines for the developing world. Despite these realities, vaccine nationalism is actually rising, as slow supplies and bureaucratic delays in rich countries have caused politicians to demand speedy action for their populations. European nations are threatening to restrict exports of vaccines and to take legal action against AstraZeneca because of suspicions that it has prioritized delivering vaccines to Britain over EU countries, which, by the way, the company denies. Dozens of countries have also restricted exports of medical supplies, which will seriously hamper efforts to eradicate COVID-19 worldwide. Now, let me be clear. It is entirely understandable that rich countries want to vaccinate their own populations first. But there is a way to act rationally and sensibly without hoarding vaccines and to make policy that will ensure that the disease is eradicated faster everywhere. Boyke and Bound lay out an excellent plan in Foreign Affairs. They argue that Washington should use the lessons from Operation Warp Speed to ramp up production and distribution of the vaccine worldwide. Washington could build the same kind of international coalition that it did to tackle AIDS in Africa. There is now a global vaccination effort to help developing countries, COVAX, which provides a powerful framework for action. Donald Trump refused to join this effort despite the participation of over 180 nations, but Biden has reversed that decision. He could go further, using it as a platform to demonstrate America's unique capacity to bring countries together around a common problem, to help raise the resources needed, and thus to solve the most pressing problem facing the world today. Go to cnn.com/Fareed for a link to my Washington Post column this week.